everybody. Welcome to the third NJSSV Memorial Lecture organized by IBS Business School, Kolkata. Sri NJSSV once said, "I will not sit on this chair even for a day more if I am not able to deliver my best." For the first time ever, he excused himself from a meeting that he chaired at 12 noon on 12th September and had to be admitted to hospital. Unfortunately, on 8th October, the same year, he passed away. Today we are here to commemorate his memory through delivery of a lecture by a luminary, and that is our best tribute to him. May I request Dr. Ajay Pathak, Director of IBS Kolkata, to please come on stage, sir. Our chief guest this evening is Mr. Kolan Devnath. Mr. Devnath is a postgraduate in physics and a CFA in addition to having professional qualifications of CAIIB. Currently working with the Peerless Group as Executive Vice President, he looks after various new diversification initiatives of the Peerless Group, business process reengineering as well as quality control. Prior to joining Peerless, he was Associate Director at Ernst & Young, where he led risk management services of the firm. In his career, which spans about 40 years, he has varied experience in the leadership role of being a banker, a consultant, an academician, an administrator, and in institution building. He was the founder, dean, and director of ICFAI Business School, Kolkata. Welcome back, sir. And currently, he is on the board of governors of ICFAI and ICFAI University. We are very, very pleased to have you with us here today, this evening, sir. May I request Professor Kolan Devnath to come on stage, please. The speaker this evening to deliver the third NJSSV Memorial Lecture is so well known to Kolkata's intellectual fraternity, and frankly, it seems a temerity on my part to attempt to introduce him. Sri Abhirup Sarkar obtained his bachelor's degree in economics from Residency College, Calcutta, and a master's from University of Calcutta. He then went on to his PhD from the University of Rochester, and has spent most of his academic career at the Indian Statistical Institute in Kolkata. He has taught at various other places in India and abroad, including the University of Florida, Brigham Young University, Concordia University, Canada, International Center of Economic Research, Italy, and of course the Indian Institute of Management, Kolkata. The primary areas of his research interests are international trade and economic development. Apart from contributing to scholarly journals, he writes regular popular pieces in dailies and periodicals. He is the chairman of WBIDFC, vice chairman of WBIDC, and a member of the West Bengal State Planning Board. Sir, it is our honor and our privilege to have you here today to deliver the third NJSSV Memorial Lecture. May I invite Professor Abhirup Sarkar on stage, please. Our students, the student community from IBS Kolkata, may I request student representatives to please come up and pay their respects to Professor NJSSV. That is the president of the student council. The vice president, please. A small floral token of our appreciation for Dr. Ajay Pathak. for Shri Kalyan Devnath. And for Professor Avirup Sarkar. May I request our director, Dr. Ajay Pathak, to deliver the welcome address. Thank you.
Shri Avirup Sarkar, Professor of Economics, Indian Statistical Institute, Chairman, WBIDFC. Shri Kalyan Devnath, Executive Vice President, PLA General Finance and Investment Company Limited. Guests, dignitaries, members of the press and media, faculty, staff and alumni members. I, on behalf of IBS Business School Kolkata, welcome you all to the third NGSSE commemoration lecture on democracy and economic development to be delivered by our guest of honor, Shri Avirup Sarkar. It is very difficult to speak about this person, Shri NGSSE. Why I am saying this is that we have kept one day in a year to remember him, and I still remember on 8th October 2011 when I got this message from Hyderabad that our Dine, our visionary and charismatic leader, passed away. A shock when I received that day is still fresh in my mind. See, NJSSE, he was popularly known as NJY, he was a brilliant student. When he continuously stood first in CA and ICW intern and final exam. He left for USA for doing his PhD, but he immediately decided to come back. Within 2 weeks of attending classes, his reason, I already know what they are teaching. I have better things to do rather than pursuing my PhD. Apparently, it seems that he was stung with the entrepreneurship bug. Mr. SSC was appointed by the government of Andhra Pradesh as chairman, Andhra Pradesh State Trading Corporation and vice chairman Public Enterprise Management Board. He was also a member of the SEBI Committee on Accounting Standards and also a member of the board of directors of the Association of Certified International Investment Analysts, Switzerland. He authored books on finance and investment. He pioneered the development of higher education in the private sector while establishing new benchmark in academic standards by setting up the Institute of Chartered Financial Analysts of India, ICFAI. With a few like-minded professionals, where he introduced CFA courses in digital learning mode in 1985, combining his sense of duty to the nation with his innate passion towards higher education. He created an institution to educate new India in financial management in its true spirit. In 1995, he built ICFAI Business School at 6 centers, and in 2000, he started building ICFAI University. By 2011, he aggressively set up 11 ICFAI universities with 5 universities in Northeast, an area where nobody would dare to venture. He had a tremendous capacity to take risk, but always launched every initiative with an amazing duty. And he said, I quote, ours is a private effort with a public purpose. NJY, being an erudite leader, whenever a new initiative was undertaken, he would invariably emphasize to his colleague, and I quote, we are aiming at a future beyond our ken and control. Let us therefore be open to learn and steer through cautiously. He always took obstacles as opportunities. I first met NJY in 2001 when he was interviewing me for the appointment as a faculty member. The brightness in his eyes, the clarity in his thought while speaking was clearly visible. He asked me, are you willing to teach and be a part of the institution building and take ICFAI to a higher level? Though I said yes, I was not very sure. I was wondering why he was asking about institution building when I come here to teach. Later on, he realized what he meant. He said these words in one of the meetings, and I quote, the dean of the institutes will be non-academic. In fact, we were surprised to hear this from him, and then he further clarified by saying, The person, of course, has to have a brilliant academic background and strong appreciation for the role to be played by academics. The person should be more than an academic leader with a vision and capabilities to build an institution. What he meant 10 years earlier is quite clear now when we saw the exponential growth of ICFAI. We were always keen to listen to him. He used to say, have wild and silly thoughts and you would be able to innovate and achieve whatever you want to achieve. I had several times on several occasions, you know, I had interacted with him. Whenever I sent a mail to him, he would reply immediately despite his busy schedule. He goaded me in completing my PhD, but sadly he was not there when I was awarded the degree. He was a genius who lived years ahead of his time. His vision will continue to guide us for years and decades to come. We all need to work with absolute sincerity, commitment and tolerance to achieve his vision and carry his dreams forward. I can continue to speak about NGY endlessly, but I would not like to come between you and Professor Abhirup Sarkar for a very interesting topic he is going to delve upon. Lastly, I would like to mention that the memoirs of NGY have already been published in a book titled Manishi, and copies of which are available in our library. The thoughts of NGY have been penned by eminent personalities in the said book. There could be great learnings from the book, particularly for the students and budding entrepreneurs. I once again welcome you all to the commemoration lecture and hope that you will have a great intellectual and stimulating evening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I would now like to invite Shri Kalyan Devnath to kindly take over the proceedings and give us his thoughts as chief guest. Thank you.
Good evening to all. It becomes a very emotional moment for me for anything which is connected to Mr. Jashoshi, because I know him, I have associated with him since 1984. Each year since 2002, ICFAI is paying tribute to late Mr. Jashoshi, the great educationist who silently contributed to change the landscape of private higher education of this country. As Professor Pathak has indicated, he was well ahead of time, a great visionary who believed in triggering change at a fast pace and with revolutionary ideas. I'll give you three instances that will perhaps merit in this occasion. In 1984, when economy was a closed economy, he pioneered the concept of ICFAI, Institute of Chartered Financial Analysts of India, in collaboration with similar institute in USA, to offer the CFA program with courses which nobody thought of any relevance in our country. And by the time the economy got liberated in 1991, there was third batch coming out of ICFAI with a knowledge pool that the country needed at that point of time. No wonder CFAs at that time, point of time, filled the vacuum that was created for knowledge resources because of liberalization, particularly in the space of capital market space. Second, he created a huge knowledge base for ICFAI with plenty of case studies, derivative books, research journals, as large as about 20 of them, and books of readings. After IIM Ahmedabad, ICFAI ventured to create a case study pool on its own as academic pedagogy. Third, beginning of this century, under his stewardship, ICFAI opened private universities at places which were lagging higher education, lagging in the higher education map of this country. As Professor Pathak indicated, five of them in Northeast, even at places like Dehradun, Ranchi, Chhattisgarh, universities are open, and you know that after that, lot many private universities have come in this country. He was always ahead of time. He was a great orator as a vivid reader. I remember hearing Rotary Sadan in 1993, he in a public seminar predicted census will scale to 20,000 in 20 years. Based on calculations of inflation expectation, growth perspective of the economy, FDI and FII flow, expected due to liberalization, census at that time was 3346, which scaled threefold from 1 1,027 in 1991, touched 21,170 by the end of 2013. At that time, some people laughed at it, how it can go to 20,000 in 20 years from 3,000. And you know, today Sensex is 27,868 after kissing 20,000 two days back. Today we are in a different economic environment altogether. The democratic strength of this country has put a government in place after a long time with mandate to a single party. Huge expectations have been built around, and there are some signs of turnaround already. GDP growth rate of first quarter at 5.7%. CPI inflation dropped significantly to 6.46%. WPI inflation at 5 years low at 2.38%. Food inflation at 7.6%. Although IIP growth rate still shows signs of improvement, recording a meager 0.4% growth. Come 2nd December this year, monetary policy may see lowering of interest rate to propel the growth further. So there is a buoyant mood around. When democracy provides stability, economic development naturally tends to flow. But can it be said with certainty? There is a old humor in terms of economic development. It goes like this. If you have two cows, then sell one cow and buy a bull. In few years, the herd will multiply and your economy will grow. After some time, again after few years, you sell the entire assets and whatever earning you make out of that, live your livelihood till retirement. Are we talking of this kind of economic development? Who else better than Sri Sarkar can dwell on this subject? This topic has been very contextual in the current business environment and would be befitting tribute to Mr. Jashashi. I invite Mr. Sarkar to deliver his lecture. There will be a question answer session for about 10 to 15 minutes after this deliberation. Mr. Sarkar, please.
Thank you very much for inviting me here and for giving me this opportunity to speak. I'll be speaking on a topic which should be of public interest, especially in a country like India, which is aspiring to become a developed nation and which can boast of having the largest democracy in the world. In terms of population, at least. The issue that I'm going to talk about is basically centered around the question of the relationship between economic development and democracy. So let me introduce the issue. Let me just try to elucidate what I have in mind. You see, over the last two decades or so, a large number of countries all over the world have become democratic. So, just to give you some idea about the democratization process that is going on in the world, you can look at a figure published by an organization called Freedom House. Freedom House was established, I think, in 1972 in the US, and its main objective is to foster and promote democracy all over the world. Now, Freedom House every year comes up with a world report, a report on world democracy. Now, according to Freedom House, in 1989, only 41% of the 167 countries in the world practiced electoral democracy, only 41%. By 2012, while the number of countries had increased to 195, the number increased because of division of countries and so on, the proportion of countries with electoral democracy had increased to 60%. So from 41% to 60%. That was clearly a significant increase in the number of countries practicing electoral democracy. Now, that in itself is good news, of course. Democracy is something that we all cherish. But the more important question is, has this, you know, spread of democracy as an institution, has it actually improved political rights, civil liberties, and economic freedom? In other words, even though it's true that the number of countries practicing democracy has increased, can we say that the quality of democracy practiced by these countries has also improved as well? This is the basic question that we shall look at. Now, how to measure the quality of democracy? There are various organizations. Freedom House, I just mentioned Freedom House, that's one, which publishes, comes up with an annual report on world democracy. Similarly, there are other organizations as well. For example, The Economist magazine, they have a democracy index. They have a unit called Economist Intelligence Unit, which publishes a democracy index, which tries to rank the quality of democracy across nations. Now, Economist magazine basically divides the countries into four categories. One is full democracy, then they have flawed democracy, then hybrid regimes, partly democratic, partly something else, and finally authoritarian regimes. So there are four categories. And the classification of a country is based on a number of variables, number of indicators like civil liberties, on how elections are conducted, the number of people participating in the election process, and so on and so forth, on media freedom, and so on and so forth. In 2012, the total number of countries listed by the democracy index is 214, out of which 116 are electoral democracies. Okay, so we'll look at 116 electoral democracies. Economist magazine, according to Economist magazine's categorization, out of these 116 countries, only 21.6% are classified as full democracy. Okay? And about 64% as flawed democracy, and the remaining 13.8% as having hybrid regimes. We are just talking about countries which have electoral democracy. Out of that, this is the classification. Now, on the other hand, the reason I'm quoting these figures is that these organizations come up with varied, you know, estimates about the quality of democracy. So Freedom House, if you just want to compare Freedom House's rankings with the earlier one, Freedom House ranks countries, again on the basis of political freedom and civil liberties. In 2013, they have listed 194 countries, out of which, as I said, 116 are electoral democracies. Now, and their categories are different, slightly different. They classify countries as free, partly free, and not free. And out of this 116 electoral democracies, Freedom House categorizes about 76% of the countries as free and only 23% as partly free. So you see, there is a wide variation in the estimates of the quality of democracy. What to make out of this? Very difficult to make out of these figures, which are varying a lot. But be that as it may, one thing is common to not only to the Economist magazine's report and the Freedom House's report, it is also common with other reports. There are various other reports. One thing is common, and that is the democracy rankings, or the quality of democracy in poorer countries, are definitely lower than that of rich countries. So this is always true. All, you know, whatever absolute standard you have for your democracy, that could be subjective, but the thing that is common to all these studies or all these reports is that poorer countries tend to have weaker democracies compared to their richer counterparts. And this is precisely what we are going to talk about. We are going to understand why economic development is, you know, the stage at which you are in is important for the functioning of the democracy that you have. This is what we are going to talk about. Now, the positive relationship between democracy and the standard of living, this is empirically, you know, it has been observed again and again, as I said. This positive relationship was first hypothesized by Seymour Lipset in 1959. That was a long time ago. He was a political scientist who traced its origin to the writings of Aristotle. So the idea is not at all new. It's known for years and years, centuries after centuries. The idea is that in order to have a proper democracy, you have to have economic development first. Otherwise, democracy cannot work. That is the idea. So this is an old idea. It was hypothesized by Lipset and also mentioned by Aristotle long, long time ago. More recently, in 1999, an economist, a very famous one, Robert Barrow of Harvard, he actually tested, you know, statistically tested to see whether there is a correlation between the quality of democracy and the standard of living. This was a very rigorous work, came out in a journal called Journal of Political Economy, which is one of the top journals in economics. And while the quality of democracy was measured by indicators of political rights and civil liberties and so on, standard of living was measured by per capita GDP and primary school attainment. And Barrow found out that quality of democracy and standard of living are significantly positively correlated. So if standard of living increases, quality of democracy improves. Statistically, he found that out. That was in 99. There were other research work in the same area. In 2006, Acemoglu and Robinson, Acemoglu is from MIT and Robinson is from Harvard, they have come up with a book which looks at a similar, you know, relationship, and they have demonstrated, they have used Freedom House data and they have added some other data. There is another data set called Polity 4, and they have come up with, I don't want to get into technicalities too much, but they have constructed a composite polity index, basically representing the quality of democracy of a country, and try to see that how far this is correlated with the level of per capita income and average years of schooling. And it turned out that both are positively correlated, significantly and positively correlated. Acemoglu and Robinson also found that over the period 1960 to 1995, democracy, quality of democracy in the OECD countries has consistently remained at the top, followed by Latin America, followed by Asia, and at the bottom you have Africa. So, you know, if you look at the time series, over the years, 1960 to 1995, the rich countries have always remained at the top in terms of the quality of their democracy, followed by Latin America, and then Asia, and then Africa. There are other researchers as well. Przeworski, he is a political scientist in New York University. He has made a distinction between democracy and non-democracy, and they have chosen a different index according to Przeworski and his co-workers. Democracy, in order to qualify as democracy, there has to be at least one peaceful change in the government in the past. So unless you have one peaceful change in the government in the past, you cannot call it a democracy, according to them. So according to this definition, South Africa is still, it's not a democracy. They have not had any change in government so far. Anyway, so whatever be the standard, again, they have come up with the conclusion that not only affluent countries have higher tendency to be democratic, they have a higher chance of remaining democratic. So democracy is more permanent in these countries. Anyway, so I can keep on giving accounts of the existing work, but let us not do that. It's not very interesting. Basic idea is that empirically it's well established that richer countries have a better quality democracy than poorer countries. And so the question is why? What is the explanation? Now, if you look at, being a student of economics, I looked at mainly at the literature on political economy, the mainstream political economy. And there, the basic model, as we call it in economics, we always go by a model. The basic model that is used in the mainstream political economy is one that was suggested by Anthony Downs in 1957. It's pretty old. The model is like this. Just consider two parties, political parties, engaged in a, in an election. So there is election, there is democracy, there is going to be an election, and there are two political parties. Imagine a straight line on which you are basically representing different policies. So if you go left of the straight line, you become more left. You adopt leftist policies. If you go right, then you adopt rightist policies. So these two parties, they have to, before the election, they have to adopt some policy stance in that straight line. The voters are distributed over this straight line. Okay, so a voter would vote for that party which is nearer to its most preferred point. Okay, so a voter has a most preferred point on the line, and he would vote for that party which is nearer to his most preferred point. So this is the framework, and the basic conclusion of this model is the so-called median voter theorem, which is very well known in the political economy literature. It says that political parties will try to adopt the policy which is most preferred by the median voter. The person who is just at the middle, he has a most preferred point, and both parties would adopt exactly that point. Now, that is a theoretical model, that's a theoretical prediction. It has several implications. The first implication is that both parties would be adopting the same kind of policy, at least announce the same kind of policy before the election. Second, both will be adopting some kind of a middle path. No extreme policies would be chosen. Third, the model would suggest that most people, that policy would be chosen which is preferred by most people because it's a democracy. And fourth, it is assumed that political parties honor their pre-election commitments. Now, none of these conclusions would hold in reality. First of all, political parties, we have seen that they do not usually honor their pre-election commitments, not always. But also, the puzzle is that in a country like India, where most people are poor, if the median policy is chosen, then we would have observed more pro-poor policies than we actually, have. So, because it's a democracy, let me just point out one thing, just as a digression. Democracy is an institution like the market. Market is another institution. But democracy is more equitable than the market in the following sense. If you have more money, you have more power in the market. But in democracy, whether you are poor or rich, you have one single vote. So in that sense, democracy fosters more equality. So if that is so, in a country like India, where most people are poor, one would have expected the governments, whoever the government is, to adopt more pro-poor policies, and poverty should vanish. After so many years of independence, we should not observe that much poverty. But we do not, observe that. So we do have poor, we do have policies which are not strictly pro-poor and so on. So this Downsian theory doesn't explain much, at least as far as less developed countries are concerned, it doesn't explain much. Of course, there are variations of Downsian theory. In 1987, two economists, Asar Limbeck and John Weibull, they sort of changed the Downsian theory a little bit. They sort of, introduced the notion that it's not only the announced policy of the political party, but also, personal charisma or personal liking of the voter, all these things would matter, caste would matter, a host of things could matter. But more importantly, the less educated the electorate, the less would be the chance of a voter to understand what is going on. To understand what a political party is really announcing, what are the implications of the policies that they are announcing and so on. So, in a country like India, where we still have a significant fraction of the voters who are not so educated, they are not aware. So it's very easy to fool them, if you like. If you want to use the word fool, then it's easy to fool them. In fact, in a country like India, what you have is, on the one hand, there is a trade-off. As far as a political party is concerned, there is a trade-off. On the one hand, you can adopt pro-poor policies, direct pro-poor policies, and get more votes. That's possible. On the other hand, you have to run huge elections, which incurs which involves huge cost. And for that you need donations, and for that, you know, to get those donations, you have to depend on a handful of the rich people of the society. So you can call it a class struggle, not in the Marxian sense, but it is definitely a class struggle. On the one hand, you need money to run elections, and for that you have to depend on the rich. On the other hand, to get votes, you have to depend on the poor. So you have to strike the right kind of balance between these two. And as a result, you see, even if there are so many poor people, you do not observe that many, poor policies. And the condition of the poor, it's changing, all right, but it's changing slowly. So this is one kind of explanation that one can provide. It depends upon lack of education, awareness of the, you know, general voters, and that is the reason why the quality of democracy is not so high in less developed countries. Now, well, there are two problems with this, at least the way I see it, there are two problems with this proposition. Number one, it is not exactly true that the poor people are not aware. In fact, in my thesis, which I'll put forward in a moment, I think the poor people are more political than the rich, because their livelihood depends upon what kind of policies the government is taking. People like you and me, who are in the formal sector, who have a stable job, we do not depend on the government that much. But the poor people do. So it's not true that the poor people are unaware of politics. In fact, they are very much aware of politics. This is number one. Number two, it's not very plausible to think that, to say that the poor can be fooled again and again. How can the poor be repeatedly fooled? They can be fooled once, because of their unawareness. But you cannot fool them again and again. So I think whatever theory one has to put forward, one has to account for the fact that the poor are very much into politics. They understand and they have their own take on the political situation of the country. We have to incorporate that in our theory. Let me mention there is another branch of literature. Like I mentioned Acemoglu Robinson, there are other people also. This branch basically says that the relationship between democracy and development largely depends upon inequality. So they actually bring in inequality, and they think that there is a big relationship, there is a very important relationship between inequality and democracy. Why? Let me explain. If you have low inequality, but suppose you do not have democracy or very low level of democracy, like in, let's say, Singapore. Okay, in Singapore you do not have democracy, but inequality is also low. Because inequality is low, the poor, the poor do not have the incentive of pushing for more democratic rights, because they're doing fine. There are always costs of pushing these things. So because you are doing fine economically, you do not have the incentive of pushing for more democratic rights. On the other hand, the other extreme, where you have extreme form of inequality in Latin American countries, there, if there is a switch over to democracy from an authoritarian regime, the rich are going to lose a lot. So they will try to protect the authoritarian regime with all their force, because they have high stakes, and that comes from inequality, huge inequality. So again, there also you do not observe democracy. It's in the middle. Countries like the UK, the USA, or other European countries, Argentina and so on, where the inequality is somewhere in the mid, somewhere in between, where there is a, you know, social understanding that you have to have democratic rights, otherwise the poor will demonstrate, they will, you know, they will try to push for more rights and so on. And these democratic rights are given to them because the rich are not losing a lot in terms of their, you know, income. Inequality is already low, not very high, I would say. So it's like an you know, U-shaped curve. You know, with high inequality, you have low democracy. It's inverted U. With high inequality, you have low democracy. With low inequality, again, you have low democracy. But in between, you have high democracy, in the middle. This is one kind of theory. Again, this theory does not help us much, in the sense that here the distinction is between democracy and no democracy. What we are trying to understand is the quality of democracy where we already have an electoral system, where we already have elections, but the quality of democracy is not very high. So we are trying to understand that. So I will, for the remaining time, I will devote to what my thesis is about, you know, explaining the relationship between the standard of living and the quality of democracy. Now, I will try to explain this through the existence of an informal sector. So let me just try to explain what I mean by that. By an informal sector, I mean a whole bunch of things. But the common thing is that in an informal sector, you do not have well-defined property rights. Now, this could be, you know, an example could be a small, you know, business which is unregistered, which is not paying taxes or paying the minimum wage. That could be one example. Or it could be someone, a hawker selling his stuff on the pavement, who doesn't have the right to be on the pavement, but still he is doing his business. Or someone who is encroaching on government land. Or some poor people who is not well protected from hooligans, let's say, from musclemen. The, you know, the law is too expensive to implement. So what I mean is, there are a whole bunch of people who are in this you know, informal sector. In a country like India, it's a huge percentage. World Bank has some figures. Now, the main point is that because these people are not well protected, they don't have proper, you know, property rights to protect them, they need political protection for their livelihood. So I think this is the basic politics of you know, of an underdeveloped country. You, in order to, people like you and me, we are in the formal sector. We don't have to depend on any political party. But for people, you know, for poorer people, because they have to survive, they need political protection. Okay? And this political protection is given by the political parties in exchange of votes. Not only in exchange of votes, these people, they can, you know, they can visibly join the party's meetings and, you know, demonstrations. They can even act as musclemen if the need arises. All these things we have seen in India, but there you can see this in other less developed countries as well, in Bangladesh or in Latin America, Africa, everywhere you can see that. So the point is that because you are vulnerable, because a person in the informal sector is vulnerable, he or she has to depend, he or she needs political protection. And this protection is provided in exchange of his political loyalty. So this is the thing. Now, if that is the case, if votes are bought through by giving small favors, then there are at least two implications of this. One is that the quality of democracy is definitely going to suffer because no one is concerned about how the government is functioning. Everyone, or not everyone, maybe people in the formal sector are concerned with the functioning of the government, but people in the informal sector, as an individual, he would be concerned with his personal benefits. He would be, for example, a hawker would be concerned with the fact that, you know, whether he's thrown out of his pavement or not, right? So on the one hand, there is a law which can throw him out. But on the other hand, political parties would, you know, protect this person from this law. Because that is how you can get his loyalty. So the point is that most people belonging to the informal sector, they do not care, they wouldn't care about the general economic situation. They would care for their survival and care about their immediate benefits from different political parties. This is number one. Number two, because the party which is in power has more, power to distribute benefits, you would observe immediate switches from one party to another. This is something that you will observe. Okay. So, if that happens, then political changes are very difficult to come by. You know, the probability, once you are in power, the probability of remaining in power would be high. So that is another problem with democracy. You know, democracy typically should punish the non-performing government, and here that is not happening. So you can, these are all testable hypotheses. You can see whether this contagion is taking place. You know, voting behavior could be like a contagious disease. You switch from one party to the other. These things can be tested. But that is, you know, that will need much more serious work. But here, what you can immediately see that there is clearly a negative relationship between the quality of democracy and the percentage of an economy in the informal sector. Okay, so I just run some regressions and just calculated some correlation. I just looked at the percentage of GDP coming from the informal sector of a country on the one hand, and on the other hand looked at the quality of democracy. Just looked at global democracy ranking, that is another organization which comes up with democracy ranking, and I found that there is a 0.67 correlation positive, which is pretty high, okay, between informalization and the quality of democracy. It should be negative, actually, negative of 0.67. Higher the level of informalization, lower is the quality of democracy. So this is all very not very heartening. This is I don't think that we don't have any hope or anything like that. One way to get out of all this is to create more opportunities for the poor people. Once the poor has more opportunity, he would not typically depend on political favors for his survival, and then he can vote on his own. You know, he can decide whether this government is functioning properly or not, and only then a democracy can function. So the question is, how to create more opportunities? I think globalization is one. So with globalization, you see all sorts of small, medium, large, different enterprises, different scopes, different opportunities are coming up. Once you get globalized, you know, in economics, like we say, no arbitrage condition. Wherever there is a possibility of profit, people would go there and earn that profit. This is the beauty of the market. So with more globalization, with more opening up of the market, people will have more opportunities, and only then their political dependence would fall, and only then democracy can work. So that is the positive note with which I would like to end my lecture, and I would be very happy to take questions. Thank you.
So we have got a very engrossed discussions on a topic which is mostly on the economic agenda, and he touched upon very important thing, that whether quality of democracy has got in relationship with standard of living. Because when you talk of economic development as well as democracy, definitely both go hand in hand, and entire discussion was focused on, is there any positive correlation or negative correlation? And while doing so, he has highlighted few things, very important things. I'll just point out few as a summary. One point was mentioned, based on studies that others have done, not that his own study, democracy fosters more equity than the what market actually provides or market propels. Second point that he has highlighted is lack of education versus policy understanding is a big issue which really concerns the government policy makers. Third point, more important point, highlighting about Singapore as well as Latin America, if there's an inequality, that will propel democratic rights. Whereas if there's low inequality, there will be no demand for democratic rights, because there's no incentive to be going for democracy. And when he came to his own study and own understanding, he touched upon one important area that is called the informal sector of the economy, who actually dictate the democratic terms of this country as well as vis-a-vis the economic development. And while dwelling upon that subject, based on his study, he highlighted there is a negative correlation between the quality of life and informalization of the democracy. And we all know that you know, this informal sector really plays a very, very positive role, or triggers whatever inequality we have in this country. And as a suggestion, he highlighted that more opportunities to be created, and globalization and more reforms may provide opportunities, which sometimes may be termed as door to this. We know that rupees 2 kg rice and other things, you know, they provide as a door. Perhaps on understanding that, you know, they will have these basic needs to be fulfilled, because you highlighted that they are more concerned about the personal benefit and accordingly switch their loyalty, and not more concerned about the economic development that will bring long-term benefit. So there, we have seen instances where governments who promoted economic development as a long-term agenda failed to again come to the power. On the other hand, we also seen government who go for appeasement of policies by throwing something as a dole to ensure that loyalty is ensured, they also suffered. I think while you take question answers, you can also dwell upon this subject.
Should I reply? Okay. You see, giving rice for 2 rupees, I think that's a general policy that would be available for everyone. So you. Important thing is that this is, in the literature it's called clientelism. See, in order that someone votes for me, I have to make sure that I give the benefit only to him and not to someone who does not vote for me. So I have to make this distinction. If you give 2 kg, 2 rupees rupees a kg rice, then everyone gets the benefit. That's one kind of policy. But more important is that, suppose you give credit, rural credit, to families which you know are closer to your party. Or you get, you give other types of, you know, benefits only to selective people. Only then you will have clientelism. That is something that is, well, we had one paper, this is with Pranab Bardhan, Dilip Mukherjee, myself and one of my students. It came out in EPW. We got some evidence of this kind of clientelism in at least in West Bengal. We surveyed in 2004, I think, 2003-04. So that is one example. So I'm not talking about the general policies, but particular policies which can be discriminatory. This is important. Okay.
So floor is open to you.
Yeah, please.
It's very hard to say because of the following reason. You see, suppose you put a restriction on private funding of elections, right? So everything is publicly funded and everything is transparent. One problem is that it's very difficult to ensure that there are no underhand dealing. That is very difficult to ensure. The other thing is that you can give and take benefits in all sorts of different ways, you know. So it's not the funding as such, but there are, it's so multidimensional. There are so many aspects of corruption. It's very difficult to control, I think. Okay, so now you are asking a technical question. Well, I have a model. I mean, what I said was basically the gist of that model, and I had what is called a global game, and I looked at the Nash equilibrium of that. The Nash equilibrium involves the following. I am an individual voter, right? I belong to the informal sector. If my party wins, I get some special benefit. But for that, I have to guess which party is going to win. That is very important, right? So, I will typically vote for that party for whom most others are voting. This is the contagion. This is just like the stock market. You know, a particular stock, if everyone wants to buy that stock, I will also try to buy it and the price will increase, right? So it's a contagion of that sort, right? Stock market or foreign exchange market, it's very similar. Each of these voters is trying to guess where, you know, which direction the wind is blowing. You know, that is very important for them. And that is what the Nash equilibrium involves. Given the choice of others, what is my optimal choice? That is the Nash equilibrium. Okay. I didn't say that. See, economic development was measured in terms of standard of living, mainly in terms of per capita GDP, but also in terms of years of schooling and other, you know, parameters. Inequality is a different, you know, indicator, and some economists have argued that it's not economic development as such, but it's inequality with which the quality of democracy is related.
Studies that show
You are right, absolutely. I completely agree. Sure. Yes. I completely agree with you, especially with this book by Piketty recently. You find that in the developed countries there is a huge amount of inequality. I completely agree with you. I will answer. First is that, is there a threshold, right? Well, at least if more than 50% of the people are free to vote, in the sense that they do not depend on political parties for their survival, then you have an open democracy. So 50% is the threshold, I would say, number one. Number two, I have never compared democracy with no democracy or democracy with dictatorship. We are comparing the quality of democracy with, you know, between countries. I am of the opinion that in India we are very, very, you know, fortunate that we have a democracy. There is no question of, you know, choosing the wrong path. We are, you know, very fortunate that we have a democracy. At least we have the chance of correcting ourselves. But the question here is that why is our democracy not functioning, you know, at the level at which we would expect it to function? That is the question. It's not a question of no democracy, you know. I think that, you know, choosing no democracy cannot be an answer. Just to supplement that, you see, there is a, I didn't mention that literature, there is a literature which tries to argue that at least for less developed countries, at least for the earlier stages of development, authoritarian regimes are better. Some people try to argue that. And as an example, they would typically give the example of Singapore or South Korea and this and that, China and so on. China, yes, yes. That's right, yes. China is visible. But you have to realize that there are many African countries which do not have democracy, which are dictatorial, and which do not have any economic development. So the point is that the fact that you do not have democracy does not imply per se that you are going to have economic development. It would depend upon so many other things, right? So in Africa, you know, if just the absence of democracy would automatically bring economic development, then Africa would be the most developed, you know, continent in the world. Okay. No, that's a different thing. No, that's a different thing. I'm not talking about India as such, you know. I'm just talking about democracy and no democracy. That's the thing. The most common index that people use is called the Gini coefficient, right? Gini coefficient is basically, conceptually it's like this. You take two individuals and you look at the difference between their income, right? And then you consider every pair of individuals, okay? And you take the average of that, something like that, roughly. This is Gini, it's more complicated, but anyway. Now, Gini coefficient is one measure which is commonly used by World Bank, United Nations and so on. You will get data on that also. However, Gini does not tell you much because of the following reason. If you look at just Gini coefficients alone, India's Gini is not so bad, you know, right? That's okay. Or you could have other measures like Kuznets ratio. Income earned, enjoyed by the top 10%, compare it with bottom 10%. there also we are not doing that bad. Why? The reason is that our inequality is concentrated at the top 1 or 2%. So it's not enough to look at the top 10%, you have to look at the top 1%. Yeah, I'm not talking about US. You see, I'm just saying that if you look at the top 1% or maybe top 0.5%, India would be a much more unequal country than the US. This is the point made by Piketty, the book I was referring to. Piketty and Abhijit Banerjee had a paper. They looked at income tax data, Indian income tax data. Of course, they didn't know the names of people, but they had access to this the kind of income people, income tax people pay at the very, very top level, right? And there you have a lot of inequality. So the inequality, it's in India, it's like, you know, the top 1 or 2%, they have everything almost, right? And then when you come down to the bottom 97% or 96%, almost you have nothing, right? So that's a much more horrible form of inequality than a typical Gini can capture. Okay.
Anybody else?
Yes, Anusha.
Yeah.
Well, now there is a problem with all these indices, you know, they are heavily dependent on the arguments that you are choosing. Multidimensional index, poverty index would involve not only your calorie intake, but also whether you have a shelter, whether you have, transport and this and that. Suresh Tendulkar had a fairly general measure of multi-dimensional poverty in India. And now whether we are doing worse than some African countries, I think my immediate reaction would be one should not come to conclusions, quick conclusions from that, because by one index I'm sure India is doing better. By another index, India might do worse. So it's not very difficult. It's not very easy to come to a definite conclusion whether India is doing better or worse than African countries. It would depend upon the kind of index that you choose. This is the problem with multidimensionality. And in that sense, the classical measures of poverty are better in that sense. It's unidirectional. It's unidimensional. It's just looking at your food intake and just looking at the calorie that you are consuming. I don't think so, frankly speaking. Africans meaning which countries? There could be countries like with oil. They might be doing better, that is possible. But not all of Africa, I don't think so. That, if you look at, of course India is not doing great, that's for sure. But if you look at, I think it's better, it's more reasonable to look at the Human Development Index, which is published by the United Nations. And it was constructed by Amartya Sen. There are three things that you look at: per capita income, health and education. Right? With 1/3 weightage on each. So that is a better index. But even by that index, India is quite at the bottom. Yes, absolutely. Yes.
Yes.
I think if the poor. See, this is a question of social mobility. If the poor had more access to everything, right, then I think things would have been different. See, one problem with a country like India is that we were talking about Gini, right? There is another thing called educational Gini. This is basically the years of schooling that a person has and the inequality about that. The educational Gini performs much worse for India. It's really bad. Very high actually. Now, educational Gini tells you what are your chances of going up the social ladder. And if there is a lot of inequality in terms of education, there is, you know, the extent of social mobility is very limited, right? So what you are going to do in future would be largely determined by exactly where you are born. This is the problem with India. Now, if that is the case, then of course someone whose father works in the informal sector, it's very difficult for him to even get a job in the formal sector. I'm not saying that no one gets a job in the formal sector, but on the whole, social mobility is difficult. And so, low social mobility, people are stuck to the informal sector and they actually depend on this kind of favors, political favors. No, I think, at least this is my feeling, that, you know, the more opportunities you create as a whole, globalization is one, I said, markets open up, this is going to change the Indian society. This is going to change, of course it is going to change directly by making people more, you know, affluent and so on, but indirectly, by making people less dependent on politics and on political parties. Yeah, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Shaka. I think we had a very good question answer session. Now I'm handing over to Professor Sina.
Thank you. What can I say, Professor Shaka? We had a brilliantly comprehensive and erudite session, as is quite evident from the number of questions answers, and you have held my students' attention, which is a fairly difficult thing to get. But may I kindly ask you to accept a very small token of our appreciation from IBS Business School. Mr. Kodlan Devnath, thank you so much for taking time from your busy schedule. Of course, you have a soft corner for us. After all, you are part of our family. So, a small token of appreciation from us, please. My very grateful thanks to the audience for being with us. Thank you, the IBS students, some alumni. Thank you, the faculty. Some of our erstwhile colleagues are also here. Welcome back. Thank you, the staff, the administration, and of course, last but not the least, our director, who has this entire event.